to the UFL. I don't know what you dudes thought. One of the best leagues in New York. So let me know if you love the sports. Stephen J. Dawn and Ghost are your host of Real Tuff Talk. Welcome to the UFL. I don't know what you dudes thought. One of the best leagues in New York. So let me know if you love the sports. Stephen J. Dawn and Ghost are your host of Real Tuff Talk.
What is going on, people? We are back with the debut of Real Tuff Talk. I'm Stephen J. I'm here with Ghost, and we're excited to be back for this new 2015-2016 season of the UFL.
Well, last season ended with a bang, but since then, there's a lot of things that's been happening in the offseason, a lot of interesting things, a lot of new teams coming, a lot of rumors about free agents. And other things that you wouldn't hear anywhere else. I'm excited to figure out what's this all about. Free agents?
Well, the first thing we're going to jump in and let you know is that Carver won the championship. Great game versus the Browns. Beat the Browns 7-0 in the championship. Very great game. And that was a great second coming of the first game where they beat the Browns 15-14. So that was a very great encore. But unfortunately for the Browns, Carver repeats the same recipe as the first time.
And that must leave a bad taste in the Browns' mouth. And in two seasons, the same way, just coming just short of a championship. And now they're looking to make this the difference maker this year because they can't go three years in a row without winning nothing. I think that they're about to do something drastic this year to finally go over the hump and win a championship.
Well, we're going to tell you what's on the menu for the top. The top categories of what's going on in the show today, I would like to say. The first thing we're going to have a big interview, a one-on-one sit-down, man-to-man, with Mr. Reloaded 2015 All-Star, the Chad, a.k.a. The Monster.
Of course, he has a lot of things to say all the time, whether it's on the field or off the field. We got a chance to sit down with him right after his team practice. You hit him with some questions, you know, whether he answered them properly, whether he left some clues, whether he left things to wonder what are you talking about. There's a lot of things to wonder in this interview, but it was a great interview overall. He had a lot of things to say, and we hope that you enjoy it.
Also, we're going to talk to you about the 2015 UFL free agents. We got a lot of guys who's coming into the league from the BQFL. Definitely want to be a part of the UFL family, and they're going to come in as free agents. So a lot of teams that can use their services, a lot of players who may not know about these guys because they're from Brooklyn, but a lot of them are coming in to show they can do football's football to them, and it's going to be interesting to see who's the free agents coming in this season.
And a lot of times, once you learn what a player is capable of, what they're here to do, it shouldn't be no question of where they're coming from. It's all about, if this person can fit on my team and help me win a championship, that's all that should matter. So a lot of these guys should be considered for your team if that's the piece that you really need.
And the last thing we're going to talk about is the injury report. We're going to let you know who's injured, what's going on. We'll have Dawn. She's off now. When the season starts, she'll be here with us letting you know the rumors of trades. Because now, in this season, between week 3 and week 4, you can pull trades. First league ever to do trades. We're excited about that. Can you imagine somebody being traded if somebody has the cojones to trade one of their players?
And this, and utilizing something like this, it's all on the coaches. It's all about if they're going to utilize this right. It's all about if they make the smart decisions that's going to help their team win and not worry about, oh, well, I don't want to hurt this guy's feelings, or we don't need him, we could do without him. Sometimes you make that tough decision that you would need to make to help your team win. And that's the difference between a coach and a person just bringing a team together and collecting league fee.
That being said, we're going to hit you with the first break. We're going to be right back. We're going to get to that one-on-one interview. We're going to get to free agency. We're going to get to injuries. So we're going to be right back. First commercial break. We'll be right back with y'all. We'll be right back with Real Tuff Talk. Welcome back. Real Tuff Talk. Stephen J here with Ghost. We're going to give you right now the man-to-man coverage interview with the 2015 All-Star, Mr. Chad, a.k.a. The Monster. Hey, people, what's going on? Stephen J here, Real Tuff Talk. Got a special treat with you. I'm here with the wide receiver slash cornerback from Reloaded, Mr. Chad. How you doing, big homie?
How you doing?
All right, we're gonna jump right in it right now. 2013 season with KDW. You get suspended for a fight. You come back last season, 2014, make the All-Star team, one of the top players in the league. Would you say that suspension helped you become a better player?
I wouldn't say the suspension helped me become a better player. I would say my Uncle Bruce helped me become a better player. Like, his constant talks on Friday, he comes, picks me up, we have one-on-one talks. Like, he created the Monster. Like, he gave me the nickname, like, was the reason why I wear 1380 years, Beckham and Cruz, but he told me that I gotta play like them. If I believe I'm them, play like them.
Okay. People say Chad is a me first type player. Chad is selfish. What would you say to people like that when people say that about you?
Everybody has their own views of people. Like, I feel that if it comes down to the wire, I have no problem putting it on my back. Like, I know that sometimes. Last year, we had a BD went down with an injury. So my Uncle Bruce told me that he was going to give me a lot of the load. So I'm ready for anything that comes my way.
For y'all people that don't know, when he says B, he's talking about Brian. The next question is, Brian is arguably one of the best offensive players in touch football.
Yes.
What is it like lining up with him on the other side as a teammate?
It's like looking at Cruz and Beckham, but even though Beattie's a Jets fan, you know, it's like Decker and Brandon Marshall to him. But it's like you have to put your best number one on Beattie. So I hope you have a good number two, because if you don't, you're in trouble.
Pam said, quote, when Chad was on my team, he was a quiet player, and he wasn't ready for the spotlight at that time. What makes you ready now?
I feel that Pim's already had his situation over there, so he wasn't ready to give me an opportunity to build my own spotlight. Here, Uncle Shaq, he tell you, if you're ready to be on the field, then he's going to put you on the field. And then when you're on the field, you got to make plays. If you don't make those plays, then you're not going to be on the field. It's basically, that's how I run.
Reloaded has a lot of weapons. Arguably the best 1-2 punch in football, which is you and Brian. But I heard from players and coaches that says Bruce is holding the team back. They say he's the type of quarterback, he's a home run hitter, he looks downfield all day. Being at his where he's at now in his career, it don't seem like he's gonna change his style. Do you think that your quarterback is holding you back?
My mama always told me if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Mm-hmm. And with me and BD working down the field, as long as we could find some recruits to fill in the middle, then you gotta move back, but then we're going to work up the field.
You see my reaction, right?
Yeah,
listen, I'm allergic to all that nonsense. All
right.
You sound good, but y'all lost a cover 22-0. Unstoppable team, unstoppable receivers, 22-0. Y'all didn't even smell the end zone. So you're telling me quarterback this and doing it, and I respect this, no, nothing against Bruce, but facts is facts. 22-0, you wasn't able to put up points, and y'all got the arguably 1-2 best punch in the league. What was Carver that hard?
Wasn't that Carver that hard, but as a team, when you see that the 1-2 punch isn't doing something, as teammates, you're supposed to, all right, Chad and BD, they're covering them, so we have to step it up.
So the other guy's got to step it up. So it's not your quarterback.
Uncle Bruce puts us in the situations that, as receivers, you have to work your way through.
Okay. We'll take that. Your coach, Shaq. He's a player's coach. So basically, he plays and he coaches. We see him playing offense now. People says that Shaq wanted to be in the spotlight, which is why he's playing offense now. He played defense. He's on offense. Even though they have other players that they feel can maybe give you more of a boost. And they said that because of, not that his lack of leadership, he leads. Obviously, he was out here with us with the kids. He knows the game. But if he would spend more time on the sideline being a coach rather than a player, Reloaded could get to that Carver, Browns level. What do you say about that?
I feel that.
And be real. Don't give me the diplomatic stuff. We know we got your coach here sitting. We know we got these people sitting, but let's call it what they call it. You're Chad. You're the villain. You like being the villain. So keep it real with me.
I feel that.
See? Keep it real with me.
I know we have fans at the show, but okay. I feel that we constantly have talks every Friday. Me, Uncle Shaq, Brian Nerley, even though, you know, we get to the house and he putting on his mayonnaise and stuff.
Right.
We get there, you know, we talk, and I feel that he's slowly understanding that sometimes, you know, a team may come out with a fast offense, so we need speed on the field. But that doesn't take away that Uncle Shaq at times can be a great blocker.
Mm-hmm.
Not at times that teams mess up and have a mismatch on the field and Uncle Shaq is toasting them like he freaking Jordan in his prime.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's crazy. But Uncle Shaq is learning, and having Uncle Bruce there and having his little brother Beattie stepping up, Beattie tells Shaq sometimes, yo, I need you to sit down.
Right.
Like, the defense don't need you today.
Right.
That's what helped us get by YMM, even though everybody's saying it was a catch. To me, it wasn't. My little cousin Kool-Aid got a good pitcher. I'm going to keep sipping my tea on that catch, you know. But I feel that Uncle Shaq is learning. And as soon as it happens, like, I wasn't here. I wasn't a part of the TFL before, but Pam's was a player coach.
Right.
And the reason why I got a part of Carver was because I made a play on Pam's.
Okay.
That made Pam's open his eyes and see my talent. So
okay.
I feel that in time, Uncle Shaq, you know, he may take the back seat and just enjoy the chips. Then he can just plan about vacations and stuff. Like.
Okay, so right now, we're in front of my audience, the Real Tuff Talk audience. You're telling me there's 7 men on offense.
It's 7 men.
Your quarterback is 1, so now you got 6.
Yeah.
You're telling me that Shaq
Uncle
is
Shaq.
Uncle Shaq. And it's funny how you're telling me, you talk about these players, which is cool, but every time you lead off, you're saying Uncle Bruce, Uncle mm-hmm. Shaq. So is your loyalty to them because they're family? Because right now you're telling me that their top 6 guys on your team, other than your quarterback, Shaq is better than everybody else on the sideline. That's not in our offense. Remember, you want your 6
yeah,
best
your
guys,
best six
and he's one of your best guys on offense, is what you're telling me.
Yes.
Okay.
Because he proved it when we played against Don't Sleep. Oh, I don't hit him over there no more.
Okay.
He proved it when we played against Don't Sleep. He proved it during the season. Like, if you had recorded most of the games during the season, you would have seen Uncle Shaq make plays on defense, make plays on offense. He made plays to help us get to that Carver game that I remember, if I'm not mistaken, you guys talked about his feet, and no one attacked those.
Okay.
So I feel that everybody talk about how Shaq's a weakness, Shaq's this. If I'm not mistaken, we got a chip.
Last question. What does it take to have that type of swagger to play in this league? Remember, there's no cursing.
No cursing.
You know what I mean? You got a commissioner that anything illegal, which y'all guys know, you could be suspended. But you're still able to play your style with swagger. That's why you was labeled a bad boy. What does it take to be that caliber player? I think it's because you love being the villain. Everybody wants to be. What makes you one of my favorite players is you're like a Reggie Miller. You like when guys, or Richard Sherman. You like when guys don't like you.
Yeah, it's fun.
It seems like you get a boost out of people booing you and saying you suck. You love that. Yeah. That makes your game better. So is that what it all takes to have that little swagger being the villain?
Well, the funny thing is that, sadly, before it was thing one and thing two, my cousin's not here no more. And he always told me, like, if someone don't like you, that means they're worried about you. So the fact that you don't like me, that means you're worried about me. I make plays through anything. My uncle puts it up there, I'll go get it. That's my job. That's my duty. I'm a receiver. Put me on defense, you throw it my way, I'm sorry. It may get picked. And then just chase me. And it's really hard to catch me sometimes.
All right. We're going to wrap it up. We're going to thank my man Chad for being here with us.
Wait. Excuse me. I'm just saying, since we on Real Tuff Talk, can you please call me my real name? Because it's actually Chad the Monster.
Chad the Monster.
Thank you.
Well, I'm glad he called himself that because now y'all know me. So now,
oh,
I'm putting a target
mode
on his back.
Oh, it's on Monster.
Everybody
mode
that says that, and like I said, he wants to be the villain, it's fine.
I got another thing. I kind of feel that, you know, since everybody talks about, you know, me getting kicked out of the league, even though, you know, I respect the quarterback of Don't Sleep, you
right
know, I felt that I should have got comeback player of the year. So, you know, I hope this year Jay's ready to break that rule and just know my mama got her shelf ready for some trophies. And I got to bring home something because she be thinking I'm wasting my time. And I'm not. I'm a real talented individual and I'm going to prove it. That big, nice Clay MVP trophy coming home this year.
We're going to wrap it up because if we leave Chad, he could be out here all day talking about himself.
All day.
As the type of player he is. So we're going to thank Mr. All-Star. Mr.
Straight out of Compton. Straight out of Harlem.
Comeback player of the year, runner-up. He did lose to Casey for that award. So we're going to thank him for being here. Reloaded all day, right?
Reloaded all day. All month.
Thank y'all, fellas. We're going to see you on your site. Thanks, brother. Real interesting interview. Once again, Chad likes to talk about himself. He gave us a lot of insight on what's going on with Brian and Shaq and Bruce. And it's interesting. The problem I have is Bruce doesn't seem to be getting better. Definitely has the talent to get better. Definitely knows what to do, knows the game. But he doesn't seem to be getting better. And Brian doesn't seem to stay healthy. He got hurt. And was unable to compete and participate in the tournament that just passed, the $16,000 tournament. He got hurt for that. He got hurt last season, missed several games, was unable to give Reloaded the spark that he gave him the year previously, winning the Offensive Player of the Year. And I think now it's more on Chad to really be prepared to step in and be the man because I don't know if Brian is going to be 100% this season.
And this is two seasons in a row where he wasn't 100%. So I feel this is something that you would be worried about if you are Reloaded. Because this was your former Offensive Player of the Year. This was your guy on offense. And all of a sudden now he's not playing a full season in 2 years. Something is wrong with that. What do you do about that? Do you find somebody as a replacement? Do you wait until he finally becomes healthy? I mean, what do? You have to keep playing regardless of what.
I don't think you panic. I think one thing, what Brian could do is something that people can't do in this league. His speed and his physical ability is almost unmatched. You got a lot of players that can do what he do, but it's very, very limited. So you definitely wait for him to be 100%, but you don't play until he's 100%. The problem is he comes back a little early, and he's not able to give you what you really need. Yeah. And it's time for Chad to step up. I think he did a great job last year. Chad is definitely a guy who can go to the next level. And what I love about Chad is he loves being the villain. He likes when people don't like him.
And he loves the spotlight.
But this team has had a lot of inside problems. They had Kool-Aid going back and forth with them. Kool-Aid's a young guy, blocker. He's been going back and forth with them. And I think they have a lot of internal problems, a lot of things financially that's is a lot on Shaq's plate that I think is taking its toll on him to have to manage, play offense, play defense, and also be the owner and also put in all the finances. I think all that stuff is going to pile up. And it may be a lot for this team to handle coming into the season.
In all honesty, that's a formula that'll lead to – that's like a ticking time bomb, and the only thing that's left is the explosion. And I feel like they need to fix it now because I think they have something good going here. They have a lot of young players. They have a lot of young talent on this team. You know, Bruce, I feel if he, you know, changes the formula a little bit, he got something with this team. They have it, but – this time, the time is running out in terms of the problems that they're having, in terms of things that we're hearing, things that's going on. Their time is running out. If they don't fix it, that explosion is eventually going to happen, and it'll be over by then.
That being said, we're going to get to our next commercial break. We're going to give you the free agent list, let you know who's available, who signed, who A, who B, who C. See me. I'm here. Now, we're going to let y'all know who's the free agents, what's going on. We'll be right back with you. Real Tuff Talk. We'll be right back. All right, guys. Welcome back. Real Tuff Talk. This is what we've been waiting for. This is what everybody wanted to see. We're going to hit you with the list right now of the free agents that we know about coming into the UFL season. If you look at the list right now on the screen, I would say the top free agent right now has to be Dre. Definitely one of the best position players. You see the quarterbacks list. I think Nelson is the top quarterback on that list. But let's talk about Dre on the position players. Dre is a great player, great two-way player. Definitely can dominate on both sides of the ball. A player. I think his numbers don't represent what he did. He had a touch, I think two touchdowns, interception. But I think it was teams going away from him that really did the toll. He helped Herbie get into the All-Star game. He helped Herbie pick up the numbers he got. He helped Sean pick up the numbers he got because of his coverage. And I think now that he's a free agent, this not only helps other teams, it hurts Violators.
And there's a lot of stats that he made in the playoffs for this Violators team that are not listed on his on the regular season. So those are the factors that you have to look into as well. He's a big-time player in the biggest stage. He's willing to perform, and he's able to make things happen no matter what
game.
Not
to cut you off, that's true, because he was the MVP of the championship game that Violators won this past season in Friday Night Lights. He was the MVP. Yes. So definitely you're right about that.
And so that's why I said that, like you said, the numbers don't necessarily reflect what dynamic player he is. He's a player that can change a game just by one or two players being involved in that play. So this is a guy that you want on your team, regardless of who of what team you are. This is a big addition to your team. Maybe a person that can get you over that hump to that championship that you're looking for.
Definitely, but there's rumors that he's gonna sign with YMM. Now, can you imagine that defense with YMM right now? They signed Breezy. They signed Alex. They got Jeremy. Now you bring in Dre. You got the reigning defensive player of the year, Rico, who may not play defense. He says he might go after an offensive award, but I say he plays defense. Now you got a team that's very, very capable of going back to the championship. They haven't done so since 2013.
And with an addition like Dre on their team, now pretty much all eyes would be on them because they would have probably one of the most talented defenses, let alone teams, on paper right then and there. Right when they walk on the field, they have one of the strongest defenses in the league.
True.
If they add Dre to this already good YMM team. So it would almost be unfair. I wouldn't be shocked if people start complaining, saying this team is unfair if they have all these guys.
Let's not get on that.
No,
let's not get on that.
I'm not saying that they are I'm gonna complain, but I'm saying they're good enough that if they play the way that they're listed on paper, it'll almost be unfair as talented as this team is.
Well, I think he's going to sign with YMM. I think that's going to hurt the Violators.
Yes.
If he leaves.
Regardless of where he goes.
Herbie's down. He's not 100%. We're going to get into his injury later. But I think that's going to hurt this Violators team if he goes to YMM. And I think if he goes to YMM, the East is now on notice. You, it's on notice. The Browns on notice. ILD's on notice. Because this YMM team is coming. If they could get Dre to sign on his team, they can go to the next level.
And the funny thing is, if you talk about YMM, a lot of things we talked about with this team, not to go on this team in particular, but we talked about their size. We talked about their toughness. Dre can bring that to their team. That toughness on defense and on offense, that cockiness, it fits right into this team. And I feel like it's almost a match made in heaven right there. So I feel like this is a deal that's pretty much, it wouldn't make sense not to happen, I would say, at this point.
The next position player we're going to talk about is Bishop. Bishop last year played with Reckless, coming off of a very, very disappointing season. But Bishop is a former MVP 2003. Look at his numbers right now. 2003 coming off an MVP season. I'm sorry. 2013 coming off an MVP season. 6 touchdowns, 7 interceptions. Great season. Won the league MVP. 2014 signs with Carver. Leaves reckless. Goes with Carver. 5 touchdowns, 5 sacks. Wins a championship. Then he gets into it with Pams about playing time. He felt Pams calls him an award or whatever. Leaves Carver. Goes to play with Reckless, no touchdowns, no sacks, 1 interception, disappointed season, 2015.
And I don't know what happened.
Father Time.
That's what you think? That's your excuse?
Bishop is not the player he was before, and the numbers back up what I'm saying. He went to Reckless and gave them nothing, nothing at all. It was like he wasn't even there. The guy is not what he was. Definitely a role player, not a guy that's going to take over a game. He can still give you some offensively. Defensively, his career's over.
I mean, we got to agree on the offensively. I think that he is still a person that can make plays on offense. He knows how to get open in gaps, and he's able to make plays on offense. Defensively, I'm not going to say that he's not the player he used to be. I feel, look.
He had one pick last year.
Listen.
He had 7 in his MVP
list. Let me say this. I feel he is the same player, but when he won MVP, the talent in this league was not on the same level as they are now. Look at all the teams that we have and look at the teams that this league had then.
So he says his award wasn't warranted then.
It's award that he won then, he won the one now. Those stats would have never held up in this league right now. I'm telling you.
Wow.
The reason why I say that is
yeah,
because.
Yeah, I say I'm mean.
Listen, the reason why I say that is if you look at footage of watching Bishop play, a lot of times, he still cheats on the ball to make a play on defense. And what happens? He gets beat. We've seen this happen time and time again. Even when he was on Carver, you hear Pam screaming on him, wanting to take him out the game because he's not D-ing somebody.
Well, if you look at this play right here, you see Shaw beating him, getting behind him. Definitely, yeah.
And that's all because either he's getting lost on the field or he's trying to cheat to make a play. Because
he's not.
And the ball goes right over his head. It's not because he's not the same player.
He's not the same player.
He is the same player, and that's the problem. Bishop is not a disciplined player at all. He's a player that does what he chooses to do. He likes to have fun. He likes to roam around. He likes to play his style. But that hurts him ultimately because a lot of times quarterbacks exploit that and catch him sleeping on defense. And that's why he had such a horrendous season coming into 2015 because he is the same player that we've seen. It's just the talent on the opposite team has gotten that much better that they figured Bishop out already on defense. That's pretty much it.
I think if Bishop would focus more on playing the game and stop worrying about playing with that juice in the bottle, he would be that player that he can be offensively. Defensively, I don't think he's what he was before. You can say it's father time. You can say it's better talent. We can both agree he's not a top defensive player. Offensively, no. He's a role player. He's going to make plays. He's going to find a way to get behind the defense. But he's not a guy that's going to carry you and give you a top-notch touchdown. Remember, 2014 with Carver, he had 5.
5 interceptions.
And
5 touchdowns.
The previous year, when he won MVP, he had 6.
He had 6.
So he still can score.
He went down by 1 touchdown.
So he can still score.
So yes.
But defensively, he's not going to give you nothing unless you put him at ball game.
I'm going to just end it with this. Pretty much on offense, he's a person that can surprise you.
Yes.
On offense. He can make plays that you really wouldn't think that he can make. He can really open up the field if he plays his game. If he actually focuses on playing his game and doing what he needs to do for the team to win, I feel like he could surprise a lot of defenses.
I think he goes to the new team, Goon Squad. I think that Brett can use him. Brett has just got a new toy in Beto. Beto won a quarterback of the year in 2014. So definitely, he's a guy who can stretch the field. He
and
can
Bishop
get the field down the field.
Downfield,
yes, so I think that's a match made in heaven if once they get on the same page. So I think Cornbread needs to go out of his way to get some weapons for Beto, and I think Bishop would be one of them. I also see Bishop possibly going to Riot Squad. He knows Pig. He's played with Pig. And I think it's if they need a player like Bishop, you know, he – is a guy that will go to Riot Squad because the type of player Bishop is, he's going to give you energy. He's not going to make the smartest plays. Sometimes he may take a flag here and there. you know, he's not going to curse. Mm-hmm. That's not one thing you have to worry about. But you got to worry about if Bishop is going to come disciplined. So I think Riot Squad or Goon Squad would be a good shot site for Bishop to land in. Next player we're going to talk about is a guy that guys are not too familiar with in the UFL, but guys from the BQFL is very familiar with, Machine. Machine is definitely a great player. Plays like a heat-seeking missile, looking for something to blow up. This guy is very physical, physical, physical. He can hit. He takes on anybody. He's not scared of anybody. He plays like a Bob Sanders, Palomalu, run in and destroy.
And a lot of times, a person physical in the middle is a person that could change a play. He can make a quarterback hesitate throwing it across the middle. He's a person that can make a wide receiver hesitate going up for the ball. Make him think twice. So sometimes you may want a coverage guy, but sometimes a physical guy is just as effective on defense. But Machine is that guy that can help you on your defense and add that physicality that a defense would need to get themselves over the top.
But it seemed like you're about to say but.
Injuries.
Come on. I knew he was going to say that.
What else can you say? I mean, this guy, that's his main weakness. He's never healthy throughout a season. There's always a certain injury that he has to battle through, and he's never 100%. And sometimes that alone will not be the same player that you would expect him to be because of these
injuries. Come on. Listen, a guy gets involved and plays. He plays 100 miles an hour every play. Goes to get it.
And maybe
injuries,
that's why.
So what?
Maybe. So what? An injury, especially like so the hand, the specifics of the injury matters because he won't be as physical as he's normally is. And that'll change his game. And if he's not physical, he is not Machine. He is not the same player. So if you don't have that physicality because he's injured, then I'm not going to say that he's still not an effective player, but he's not the same player and he's not as worth. His worth isn't the same to your team if he's not 100% healthy. And I feel even he would agree on that. When he's not 100%, he's not performing the way we know Machine can. And sometimes that's something that a defense needs to consider.
Well, I'm not going to lie. He played today. I just did his game today. When the show goes up, hopefully we're going on time. But the previous Sunday that I just did his game, he wasn't 100%. He has nagging injuries. He has a knee. He had the shoulder. Risk. So this guy is injured, but an 80% Machine is a lot better than 100% of other guys. He's going to go and make a play. He's going to get physical. What I think Machine needs to step up is he has to step up on his coverage. He's a great zone guy, but he has to step up on his man-to-man coverage. I see Machine going to a Riot Squad who just signed Speedy to play the middle. Machine going to play the other side because Pig plays defense no more. He needs to focus on offense. Definitely a big offensive player. He's tall. He can get the ball. And he has deceptive speed. So I think now, if Pig can only focus on offense, he could definitely give Riot Squad more. I also see Machine possibly going to the Browns because the Browns signed Mills. You know what I mean? Mills is definitely a top-notch player. He plays the middle. And they could fit Machine there. So I think it's between those two. I think the wild card team picking him up might be YMM. Because he's played with YMM in other leagues, not as YMM, but on SYS. But I think the front runner for Machine will probably be Riot Squad.
I mean, regardless of which team you consider, there's players on that team that he's played with already.
Right.
So there's a lot of guys that he's already familiar with. So I think he'll fit in with whichever team he picks. It's all up on which team picks him up or what team he decides to play with.
Next player we're going to talk about. It's crazy. Now, we all say that Father Time never loses. Crazy's giving him a run for his money. Crazy's over 40 years old, still making plays offensively. Still can get open. We've seen him play in the BQFL. We've seen him play some games with Reloaded. Definitely can give you some offensively. I don't think he's a defensive guy anymore. I think his coverage, he can't really cover nobody one-on-one. I think he does not work well in schemes. He tends to get lost on the field. And I think offensive, where you want to use this guy, definitely can make plays. And definitely after the touchdown, I love the celebration with that roundhouse kick.
Yes. I mean, one thing I could say is for a 40-plus guy, This guy is still an athlete. He's a person that has deceptive speed. He has a quick first step, and he's able to go after the ball.
I see him possibly going to maybe playing with Bread and Goon Squad. They can use him. Like I said, they got Pito throwing the ball, so they can use Crazy to get open. Crazy can still make some moves to get open. He's definitely going to give you energy because this guy only knows to play one way. That's fast and hard. Yes. So definitely he's going to give that to you. So I think that's one team he's possibly going to. I think a wild card team would be Generals because of his relationship with Spaz. But I've heard sometimes Crazy's emotion can chase you away. So I don't think that's going to happen with him going to the Generals, but I think it's a possibility. I think it can open up the field. Crazy can still get down the field, which some of the Generals could use to take some attention off of Sesso and Shy. So I think Crazy can definitely give you some. So those are the two teams I see him going to. I think it's a possibility. Riot Squad, who got Militia players, can pick him up because he can get open on offense. He can stretch the field. So I say those are the possible teams, but I think the main front runner will be Goon Squad.
And in all honesty, in my opinion, he's a great offensive player, like we've been saying. But the emotion is the key to this to this player right here. Crazy, when he doesn't get, when things are not going his way, if you don't look him off when he's open, he tends to get very emotional, and it affects his play to the point where he's not 100% the way that you would normally see him. He kind of scales back. Because the emotion pulls him out of the game. So I feel like that's his main weakness. If he can get past all of that and just worries about getting the team a win, I feel like past that, he will be a big add to whatever team he chooses to go to. More so than the two teams that we mentioned. I feel like he was a good fit to whoever, but it's all on him on that point.
Now it's money time. What everybody wants to see, the quarterbacks. Definitely the quarterback list is something to look at. You can look at it right here. Definitely a great quarterback group. But right now we're going to have the first quarterback signed who's no longer a free agent. Rumor tells me and my inside sources tell me that Nelson, the top quarterback this offseason, re-signed with YMM. Rico worked out a deal. I don't know what he did because Rico had said that he's going with JJ. So I want to know how JJ feels to have been told he got the keys to the car to sit down and say, now you're just a passenger. Wow. Nelson is driving.
Honestly, I kind of saw this happening a mile away, mainly because I don't see Nelson jumping to feel comfortable in any other team. He's already been to YMM with YMM. He's been playing with Jeremy and Rico in other leagues, not just this one, for a good couple years now. And I feel like he's not going to just start over with another team and build that trust, that relationship again with another team. I feel like he's at home, and he doesn't feel comfortable just jumping ship to somewhere else.
I think it's all on Rico now. You went out. You said you was getting with JJ because Nelson and Jeremy wasn't getting along. You're still bringing these two players together. You got weapons. You got Breezy, one of the best athletes in this game. I think he is one of the best go-getters in this game, and now he's signed to YMM. You got Breezy, one of the most talented players in this game. You got Jeremy, one of the best players in the game. You have Rico coming off of a defensive player of the year, and now you bring back Nelson. And if you can sign Dre. If you can sign Dre, like we talked about earlier, and now you got Nelson, you have an opportunity to be the best team in the East. But is Nelson prepared to be the leader? His favorite player is Cam Newton. But we've seen a lot of, we know he has Cam Newton's talent, but he also has Cam Newton's immaturity. Nelson is coming into this season 13-7 off the All-Star team. He won 13 touchdowns, 7 picks. He made the All-Star team. But the question is he ready to be a leader? We still see him going back and forth with referees about calls. We still see him going back and forth with Jeremy. And is he ready? YMM has not been to the chip since 2013 when they had Ralph that took him there. Last year, Nelson lost 2 Generals in the first round.
And I'm going to say this. In terms of YMM and Nelson in general, I feel like his leadership is the key to his success. And
what leadership?
No. Listen to my point. Meaning, if he can become that leader, like you said, if he's a person that's going to take the helm, choose who he wants on offense, set up the plays, take full control of his offense, and not let nobody question it. If he becomes that quarterback, say like a Chuck, on Carl Vermont. If he becomes that type of leader, the sky's the limit for this kid because we already know the talent that he has. He already came from an MVP award in the BQFL. So we know he's talented enough to lead a team, but it's all on him. The decisions he makes, the maturity he has, and the leadership he brings to an office and to a team in general. Once he has that, he can take this team anywhere. I feel that. That's my opinion. Once he gets that over, done, the sky's the limit for them.
The problem with that is we've been saying that for the last 2 years.
We have
when
to
is it going
to
happen? He has not taken this YMM team to the next level. They got rid of Ralph and went with Nelson. Ralph took you to the championship. I don't care what nobody says. Nelson has a lot of big shoes to fill. He has not take YMM past the second round. So what is Nelson giving you? I don't care about the award in BQFL. I don't care about the All-Star game in the UFL. I care about chips and That's chip cool. appearances, and he's not done that yet. So he can be Cam Newton. He can be Superman on the field. But I think this kryptonite is winning games.
Wow.
Because you got to win games here to win.
It's like we're taking turns being a villain here.
No, he is the most talented quarterback in this league. And I'm talking about he's more talented than Chuck. He's more talented than Fred because what he can do all together, running, throwing, he has that. The problem with him is his decision-making is not where these quarterbacks are. And if I don't care how talented you are, if you don't have the mindset to back that up, you may as well be sitting on the bench.
There's nothing else to say about that.
So that's going to be said. Like I said, it's been confirmed through sources that Nelson has signed with YMM. Next quarterback up, you have Dave. A lot of people don't know about Dave. I personally know about Dave. Dave has ended my TC Warriors run. We went to 4 championships. We played against Dave. Dave beat us twice. Dave is a great quarterback. He's played in the Church League before. He played with the Renegades in the UFL when it was originally in Brooklyn. He knows the rules. He's experienced. He has chips. He can take a team to the next level. If you have a team that's already established and needs a quarterback, this is the quarterback you want.
And I feel Dave, pretty much, if we're talking about Dave in general, I think his main strength as a quarterback is his brains.
Yes.
feel like he's probably one of the smartest quarterbacks. When he walks on the field, he's probably one of the smartest guys on the field because his decision-making is off the charts. He's a person that, under pressure, he can make the best decision for his offense and help them lead them to wins and ultimately championships. He's done this before, unlike certain players that we've talked about in the past. He's already been there. He's already done it. It's already part of his resume. So all it is fitting himself into a team in the UFL and putting it all together and winning that chip.
Well, that's the main thing I see Dave possibly. I like him going to them Geddes. Them Geddes need a quarterback. They went after Reggie. Didn't work out. It looked like Reggie's going back to the Browns. They need a quarterback. The problem is they don't know Dave. They don't know what Dave to do. They can look at a few games from Tuff Talk, BQFL. They can see Dave through for the Spartans. Definitely a great quarterback. Took the team to a championship versus Rebels. They lost. But he definitely is the type of player who can make plays. And I think if Hollywood is an actual leader, he can go out, make it work, get Dave, get him familiar with this offense, and go. Because I've heard Watt is not going to be here this season. He doesn't have Swiss to throw because Swiss is throwing for the U. And now it's time for them Geddes to get to the next level. They lost in the first round last year. So they took a step back after being in the Final Four. They need to make moves.
I mean, it was a lot wrong with this team last year. I don't even want to get into that. A lot of guys didn't show up. It's a lot.
Megatron didn't show up.
Yes. So we would be here all day talking about the problems they had last season. But the main thing is they didn't really have a cemented quarterback on the field.
Right.
And that can change if they bring Dave to this offense. I feel like Dave would fit in because he's a person that can learn an offense quick. Like I said, he's probably one of the smartest guys on the field when he walks on it. So
right.
I feel like he can watch a team. Look at their talent, and he can fit himself right in and adjust. So I feel he is a good match for them Geddes, or whatever team he chooses, or whatever team chooses him. It'll be a big plus to your team to have a championship caliber quarterback like Dave on your team.
I also see him going to a team like 99 Problems. Definitely a team that can use Dave's services. They're trying to rebuild, trying to get things together, and Dave's a guy who can play with them. The wild card I see is possibly Don't Sleep. I know they have Casey as quarterback, but you have times Casey doesn't seem like he wants the quarterback. And like I said, it's a wild card because Casey's coming off of comeback player of the year. But until Casey's ready to say, I am the quarterback of this team, rather than they made me the quarterback of this team, he's not going to be the elite quarterback that we know he can be. He's not a downfield thrower, guy who chopped the field up, but definitely a guy who can make plays. And like I said, he's coming off a comeback player of the year. He won at it for a reason. But if he decides he doesn't want a quarterback, I see don't sleep picking up Dave. Those are the teams I think Dave can go to. Next up, we're going to have a guy that everybody really doesn't know about, Chino. Chino's a quarterback that threw for the Rebels in the BQFL. This is his last season. He said he's going to retire. Definitely up there, 40-plus. He's in his 40s. And he says this is going to be his last season. Has, I would say, a slightly above average downfield arm. Chino's problem is he doesn't make the best decisions at times.
And sometimes that's the difference maker between a win and a loss. In leagues like this. So at the end of the day, it's all on him if you're going to win or lose. So when he plays well, when he makes the right decisions, you're in for a win. If he doesn't make the right decisions, it's going to look bad out there towards the end of the game. So it's all up on which Chino you get. Talent-wise, I think that he has a sufficient arm to get it to your players, so I feel like that's a plus. It's all about which Chino you get. But for a team that doesn't have a quarterback or a team that doesn't have a cemented quarterback on your team, I feel like Chino is a good look for your team because he can perform for you. And pretty much it's better than just going another route with not having nothing.
I really don't know where Chino's going to go. I don't think people are going to really give him a chance because they don't know him. That makes them fools. Because like I said, if you look at this film that we're showing you, that he played quarterback, you see him throwing the ball around, this guy can make plays. Got to give him an opportunity if you need a quarterback. Next guy up is a guy who actually played in the UFL last year, quarterback Sarge. Sarge definitely signed with Street Fam week 2. First game was against Carver. He's never played with Street Fam. Didn't know Street Fam. They picked him up. He threw 3 touchdowns. They lost by 9 to Carver. 3 touchdowns. 1 interception, definitely played good, definitely a quarterback that I see that was able to take this team to the next level. They released him because they wanted his pass to throw. He ended up signing with House Gang, terrible season. As soon as he went to House Gang, a team that does not have athletes.
And that's the difference maker right there.
He threw 10 intos, 2 picks, 2 touchdowns and 10 intos. So 3-1, 3 touchdowns, 1 interception against Carver. The eventual champs, 2 touchdowns, 10 intos when he went to House Gang. Altogether, that's 5 touchdowns, 11 intos.
And what is the difference between these teams? Talent or athletes. Street Fam had athletes that will jump, and they had speed. They had the ball.
The reigning MVP, the guy who won the MVP shot.
So pretty much they had a lot of guys that knows how to go and make plays, shot especially.
Right.
So when you have guys like that out there, it makes it easier for a quarterback to just
put the ball
up there and make sure they go get it. And that's what this Street Fam team were in that game, and that's why they did somewhat well. They didn't come up with the win, but they battled to the end. And Sarge pretty much did his job on that team. He's a person that, if you have athletes that'll go and get the ball, they will make a play for you. He can put up there for your receivers to get the ball.
And then he went to House Gang and did absolutely nothing. They don't have athletes. The biggest player they had is JP, who went to the All-Star game, a receiver that goes to get the ball. Not the fastest in the world, but he can go get the ball. He had success with him, but the team was not successful. He ended up leaving the team, ended up just taking the rest of the season off, and now he's ready to come back. And the question is, who's going to give him an opportunity? Definitely doesn't have a big arm, but can get the ball to an athlete. So if you got a receiver that can go get the ball, Sarge can do it. I see him going to a team like 99 Problems, possibly, because he's thrown for them before. They probably have a guy like Mimi coming back. Mimi, Carver guy, Sour Factory quarterback, can go get the ball.
Yeah.
I think that will be a match made in heaven if he goes with that team.
Because one thing I'm going to say, Sarge is not the type of quarterback that's going to make an offense better if they're lacking.
He can't run.
No, he's not mobile, and he's not a quarterback that can improve an offense on his own. He's a quarterback that if he fits into an offensive system that has athletes, you will have success.
Which is what he did with Street Fam. Absolutely.
That's exactly the type of formula you would have if you have the type of quarterback like Sarge. If you have guys that are athletes that don't have a quarterback that can get them the ball, Sarge is the person that you would need. If you do not have any athletes or any playmakers on your team, and you're a team that's just coming up and you're still trying to find pieces,
do not go after him.
It is not a match. Sarge would not be a good choice for you, but it's all about formula and who needs what. It's all up to who makes the right decision and who picks him up.
Last quarterback in LA, we got Landy. Landy used to throw with the Browns. Doesn't throw for them anymore. Still cool with them, but doesn't throw them. Unfortunately, we don't really got any video of him. We'll show his picture, and you just got to take our word for it. Anybody that plays football knows Landy. He threw in co-op. He's throwing in numerous leagues, doing BQFL, doing EHS. He's a strong arm. He has a big arm. Not accurate, kind of average accuracy-wise. Definitely can get the ball downfield, but does not make the best decisions in the world.
And like we say time and time again, the decision-making sometimes is more important than the talent. It's more important than the arm. It's more important than even the accuracy at times. So if you don't make the right decisions on who you're throwing the ball to, that can lead to a loss. And that's all she wrote.
But if you need a quarterback and you don't have a quarterback,
yes,
I'm signing Landy. He can throw the ball.
Yes, and he can make things happen with his arm alone. So I feel like that's a plus more than a minus for a team that needs a guy that can go downfield,
right,
who can stretch the field. And the UFL has a big field. So you need a quarterback that can reach 80-plus yards. And Landy is a guy who can reach 80-plus yards. So if you are a team that needs a downfield quarterback or a quarterback that can stretch the field, Lonnie's a choice for you.
Well, we're going to rack up. We're going to wrap up this session right now. We're going to go to our next commercial. We're going to talk to you about injuries, things upcoming in the UFL / Real Tuff Talk. We're going to be right back with you. Real Tuff Talk. Taking a break. We'll be right back. Welcome, welcome, welcome back to Real Tuff Talk.
Don't do that, please.
That sound hot.
No, you don't.
Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Guys, if you approve of that, let us know.
Real Tuff.
I don't think y'all would either. Don't tell them not
to talk.
That's silly and annoying.
Anyway, we're going to take you now. We're going to talk to you about some injuries right now. Definitely something we're going to talk about. First injury I want to talk about is 2015 UFL All-Star MVP, Herbie. Definitely league MVP. Came in third in the voting. Trev was higher, number two. Trev from the Browns. And Trev evidently lost to Shy, who is the MVP of the league from Street Fam. Herbie hurt his knee. Friday Night Lights, went down. Knee injury, torn meniscus. Definitely not good news. For all y'all that don't know, meniscus is the bumper in the knee that takes the impact from the joint in the knee. So when you tear that, there's three things that can happen. If it's not a big tear, it can heal on its own. Or if it's torn, they can either repair it, which means they go in, they stitch it up. It takes time to heal because of the stitches. You could be out maybe a month and a half, because it's the stitching must, you know, heal the meniscus. But you could come back 100%. If they have to remove the meniscus because it's torn too bad, you could be back in 3 to 4 weeks, but you're more likely to develop arthritis. I had my right meniscus moved in my right knee. They removed it. I was able to continue playing. I came back rationally, we'll say quickly, 3-4 weeks. But I was never the same. Not able to jump the same. Didn't have the same blow away speed like I had coming up. This was some years back. And I was never the same because the bump on my knee was gone. Now, don't get me wrong. The way the medicine is now is completely different. This was, I would say, was about 17 years ago. So a lot of things, it's different, but it still remains the same if they remove it or if they repair it. Back to Herbie. He's down. I don't think he's going to play this season. I don't think he should play this season. But I think that hurts Violators because they already looks like they're going to lose Dre. So if they lose Herbie, this team has to score 40.
and that's a lot of problems for the Violators with a team that already has problems.
Internal problems, yeah.
As it is. So I'm going to say this. I don't agree. I feel like Herbie should sit this season out regardless of what happens, because you got to worry about your health first. You got to worry about your future, especially when you want to play this game to the height and to your caliber. It's not as fun if you're not playing at the same level that you're used to playing.
Right.
So I feel like he should just sit the season out, let his knee heal the best that it can, and then come back stronger. But do I see him staying out and not playing, especially with all the things that he's been going through lately, you know, with his father passing.
He lost his dad. We want to once again, on behalf of Real Tuff Talk,
yes,
give our condolences. Yeah, we lost a lot of people, man.
Yeah.
Herbie lost his dad. We lost Johnny, former UFL player, played with Unknowns, came into the league, played with Kill Bills. We lost him. And we also, a few weeks ago, we lost Rockstar, played with Gravediggers. No Remorse. He played with No Remorse. I'm sorry. Definitely a BQFL alum. We lost him. We want to send our condolences to those players because we have football family. But definitely been a hard time in touch football. But go ahead with Herbie. Sorry.
Pretty much. Thanks for mentioning that, though. That was really important to mention. But do I see him going through, you know, this emotional time and just sitting out and watching everybody else play and him sitting there and watching from the sidelines? I don't see it happening for too long. I think Herbie's a player at heart. He's not a person that would, if he feels he's capable of, is capable to, he's not going to sit on the sideline and watch. He's going to eventually try his best to come and play earlier to help his team win. And because I don't see it in his personality to sit out for a full year. Do I agree with it? No. But do I see it happen that he's going to play earlier than he should? Yes. I really see him that he's going to come and play anyway.
Herbie's going to play. He lost his dad. He wanted to be able to give his dad his all-star MVP. Unfortunately, his dad didn't make it to do that. And Herbie's going to give you everything he got for his dad. So I think he's going to play. Do I think it's a bad idea? It all depends on how he feels. If he's not physically able to do it, I don't think he should push it. But I think Herbie's going to play. I think he's not going to be where he was last season, but he's going to play. Everything with Herbie's his knee. And without that, he's not going to be anything near the play he was last year.
And I'm going to say this. If he does play, not only would it be him slowing down his healing process, but it'll ultimately be a blow to the team if he plays
too
early.
They need him. Their secondary's broken up without Dre.
But,
and Macho's not the type of guy who's going to hold on to the ball. We've seen him drop a lot of interceptions.
So you're saying
Macho is a great leader. He can put the defense in the position to win. Similar to Danny and Carver. The problem, Danny on Carver Mob. The problem with Macho is he drops a lot of interceptions, which can be our turnovers. We've seen him do that against Raw in the playoffs. Violators was number one. Raw was the last seed. He dropped a big interception. Chuck scored a few plays later. That would have been a turnover. Macho drops picks. It is what it is. They need Herbie, but Herbie's not going to be there this season the way he was. I think the Violators are in trouble.
And that's what I'm saying. Ultimately, it's problems regardless of what decision he makes. I think they need help fast. They need some decision-making before the season starts, or they're going to have a lot of problems to look at.
The next player we're going to talk about is Reloaded. They signed Junie. Junie used to play with Don't Sleep, but he got hurt. He got into an argument with Joel for whatever reason, left, went to Reloaded. He was supposed to be the guy that brings the physicality to this team. He was supposed to take some relief on defense off of Brian and off of Chad. I think Chad is the better defensive player than Brian. I think Brian plays purely on talent, but he's learning to get better. But now that they lost Junior with a wrist injury, he may not make it this season. That's a big blow because Brian himself cannot stay healthy. He got hurt, missed the $16,000 tournament. He got hurt, missed half of the season Reloaded. The problem is, can Brian stay injury-free? I don't think it's possible.
And he hasn't the last two seasons, and that really hurt Reloaded's play this past year, I would say, especially because now all the pressure's on Chad. Especially on defense. So Junior was supposed to be the relief for that, you know, being a physical corner more into, you know, roughing guys up on defense.
Right.
But now that they most likely won't have him because of injury, I think that it's a problem for Reloaded because that's two guys that that most likely will be down. And now even more pressure will be put on Chad to perform on both sides of the field. It's problems for Reloaded right now.
That being said, we can wrap up the show right now. We hope you enjoyed it. We're going to let y'all know about some new things coming up. We got a new family, you know, new entity of Real Tuff Talk. It's called Real Tuff Sound, where we display the talent of a lot of guys in the league. We got a lot of guys that do music, a lot of guys do a lot of numerous other things, and we want to be able to use our show to put it on display. We got Ace from IOD. He does music. We have Herbie, who from Violators, we just talked about him. He actually did the song, the intro of Real Tuff Talk. Definitely a fire song. Everybody loved it. He does music. You got Happy Feet from Carver. He does music. You have a lot of different people that does music. You got KK, who also, he's not in the UFL,
yes,
but a lot of people know who he is. He's a part of the Real Tuff Sound team. So definitely, we have a lot of people that's going to contribute and show their talents on our show. We're very excited about that chapter.
And I feel like it's a big addition because a lot of these guys support our show. A lot of these guys, you know, tell us what a great job we're doing. They support us, you know, through thick and thin. So I feel like this is our way of giving back to them and showing support for them and their endeavors and what they're trying to do and keep that movement moving and getting their sound out there to other people to hear.
That being said, listen, we want y'all to follow us, man. We you'll see in about another week, Real Tuff Talk Facebook is up. You know, we're going to have it. What we're doing right now, we have a little maintenance done to it. It's going to be up. Hit us up on there. A lot of the show will be on there. Hit us up on, subscribe to Ghostmaster page.
Ghostmaster 3223 on YouTube. Subscribe on that. You will pretty much get first dibs on whenever the shows are coming up. Whenever we're talking about when the show is up, you'll be the first to know because you subscribe. You'll be the first to see it, and you'll be first to know the ins and outs on what's going on.
You'll also be able to see some of our bloopers, some of the mistakes, some of the arguments behind the scene me and Ghost have.
Yeah,
we have all that.
He's messed me up so many times, you'll finally get to see it on camera.
So we're going to have that recorded, stuff like that. Also, we're going to be, this season, when we're recording, we'll let you know exactly the day we're recording. It'll be posted up on Facebook, either on my page, Jay Brown, on Facebook, or Real Tuff Talk, or on Instagram. If you see that, the UFL page, if you see we are recording now, whoever calls first and gets through, we will let you be on the show live. You can ask us whatever question you want. We'll have an interview with you. We'll answer whatever you want. And you'll get a free shirt. We're going to have UFL shirts, UFL hats, UFL sweaters. So you're going to have a lot of things that you could call in, you could get. So we're excited to give those stuff out. You can also go to www.theufl.org. Go to the guest book. Leave your comments. Leave your questions. Anything. You want to get at me. You want to compliment me on how good I look or how much I destroy Ghost on the show. Go on there. Leave your comments, leave your questions, anything you think we should ask, put it up there. We'll talk about it. If you don't want to leave your name, you can be anonymous as long as there's nothing, no profanity, nothing. We'll talk about it on the show. So we're excited about that. We want y'all to be a part of it. Listen, guys, we're getting bigger. As you can see, we added the microphones. We're trying to get the sound better. We hated that echo you heard in the background. So we got rid of that. Hopefully you appreciate and are excited about the upgrades we made on this on Real Tuff Talk Show.
Pretty much, there's a lot of things that we're doing. We're trying to make the show more interactive with our viewers, that people who watch the show all the time. We're trying to make things a lot better, more official, more enjoyable, more, you know, streamlined, getting things done faster, having more things out for you guys, the merchandise, things that you can represent us, have everybody in the street see who Real Tuff Talk is, who Jay and Ghost is. So we want you guys to show love for us by picking up our shirt, showing it to people, wearing it out in the street, representing Real Tuff Talk in the UFL, and showing everybody else what it's all about.
The shirts are also going to be on sale. We have the little new store that's at the UFL field. They'll have some of the merchandise. You can purchase it there. If you're not able to get through, because everybody won't get through to speak to us on while we're doing the show. So you can purchase it. You can still show support. Listen, Real Tuff Talk is getting bigger. We're going to always remember our fans. We're going to take them with us. The people supported us, we're going to support them. So, guys, like I said, we're going to wrap the show up. We want to thank y'all for being here with us. Like I said, Dawn will be here once the season starts. We're excited to have her back. I'm ready to go. You got Ghost ready to go. We're going to give a shout-out to Tim. Tim and Danny, definitely the vice president and president of UFL League. Shout-out to them. Shout-out to Darren of the BQFL, allowing us to do Tuff Talk there. Shout-out to everybody who showed love to the show, man. You got Ock. You got Tiki, you know, from Primetime. You have Danny from Carve. We got a lot of people. You got Chuck that watched the show. You got Spider from that plays with Don't Sleep. We got a lot of people that watched the show. Ruben from Don't Sleep. A lot of guys that watch the show.
Well, you mean Spider from Rep City.
Rep City, I'm sorry. Yeah. He also plays with Don't Sleep and other leagues. He plays with Don't Sleep also. But again, Cecil from Generals. I'm trying to remember everybody. So many names. But guys, like I said, hit us up. www.theufl.org. Guestbook. Ghostmaster. 3223. Subscribe. Real Tuff Talk. Facebook. Go at it. Check us out. Guys, we're trying to get big. We need y'all to go with us, all right? That's being said, I'm Stephen A. Stephen J.
Yeah, don't get sued now.
Yeah, I don't want no lawsuit. Stephen J. here with Ghost. We want to thank y'all for being here with us. Real Tuff Talk. We out of here. See y'all next week, man.